The third method for the common subvaluation is the free cash flow. Before we begin, let me give you a quick review of the methods we discussed so far. The first method was the dividend discount model, and the second one was the residual income model. As I said in the beginning, each method is quite different from the other one, and each one of them requires certain conditions to apply. The first method, the dividend discount model, requires that the company pays dividends. The second method assumes that the company may not pay dividends in one quarter or one year. In this case, we can use the company's earnings per share. And now we are facing a third possibility, that the company may end up with some losses. If the company incurs some losses in one quarter and one year, so the second method, the residual income method, is not applicable. And that's why we move to a third approach, or third method, to value the common stocks in case the company incurs losses. And even if the company doesn't incur any losses, the model or this method is still applicable. But the free cash flow, this is a very common concept in accounting and finance as well. The equation for the free cash flow is quite simple. It's equal to the net income plus depreciation minus the capital expenditure, and it refers to the amount of money that the company ends up with after the company covers the capital expenditure, which is this one. So the free cash flow means literally that the company has a free cash to pay for whatever purposes, such as paying dividends, for example. This equation shows to you as well that even if the company ends up with some net income, some sorry, negative net income, still the company is able to achieve some positive free cash flow if the company doesn't have any capital expenditure at all, because the depreciation, as I said, is what we call it non-cash expense. So it's part of the company's earnings. The model requires two steps, but the first step is to calculate the value of the firm using the same dividend discount model, but using the free cash flow instead of dividends. And the second step is to calculate the real value per share, which is the objective of this topic. This is a quick review of the difference between the dividend discount model and the free cash flow. This is what I said in the beginning. The dividend discount formula includes two components, the numerator and denominator. The numerator actually is the same as the free cash flow equation, the equation that we just reviewed, but in a different mathematical format. But anyhow, the numerator is the free cash flow, and the denominator is the discount rate excluding the growth rate of free cash flow. We have a new concept in this equation, which is the required rate of return, K. Actually, we use a very well-known model to calculate the required rate of return. It's called the CAPM, which stands for the Capital Asset Pricing Model, offered by Professor William Sharpe. The CAPM consists of two components. The first one is the risk-free rate of return on any instrument of investment issued by the government. In addition to a risk premium, this is equal to the market risk premium multiplied by the asset beta. But we have a new, a second new concept, which is the asset beta rather than beta. And we can convert the equity beta, the very usual beta that we calculate in Excel using the slope equation. We can convert the equity beta into a asset beta and the vice versa using this equation. So the asset beta in this equation actually equal to the beta for equity divided by this part. This is again the same equation. I'll give you a simple example about how we calculate the equity beta. We assume for now that the company doesn't pay dividends, which means that the first approach is not applicable. The risk-free rate of return is 4% and the market risk premium 7%, and the percentage of equity to debt ratio 40%, tax rate 35%, and the equity beta 1.2. The equity beta is what we calculate in Excel using the slope equation. Now we can calculate the risk-adjusted discount rate, or what we call the required rate of return. If we need to calculate the asset beta, actually the asset beta equal to the equity beta, which is provided here, divided by this quantity, and this is exactly what we did here. When you do this reverse, I mean the asset beta equal to 1.2 divided by this quantity, you end up with this figure, and then you substitute this figure in the CAPM equation in here, so you end up with the required rate of return, which is this figure. The next step is to calculate is to calculate the real value per share. This is a very simple and direct substitution into the equation. Again, we have certain givens in this example. I'm reading it for the sake of clarity. The EPIT is, this stands for the earnings before interest and taxes, 45, which is this one. The depreciation is 10 million, which is this one. The capital expenditure is 3 billion, which is here. The growth rate of free cash flow is 3, which is G, the same as this one. And we have the debt equal to 500 and the number of shares equal to 50 million. The current stock price is 63.36. Actually, these three pieces of information are used to calculate the debt to equity ratio. The amount of debt is 500, but the value of equity equal to the number of shares times the stock price. So when you divide 500 by 50 times the stock price, this is equal to the debt to equity ratio, and this is what we use in order to convert the asset beta into equity beta, and the vice versa. And now when you substitute these figures into the this equation, the EPIT is 45 million. The 1 minus T, the T stands for the corporate tax rate, which is 35%, plus depreciation 10, minus the capital expenditure 3, multiplied by 1 minus the growth rate, divided by the K. The K here is the required rate of return, which we calculated using the CAPM, and the growth rate of free cash flow is the same as this one. So we end up with value of equity. We end up with the value for the entire firm, 3500.39 million. And if we assume here that the company has a debt equal to 500, which is this one, so we can calculate the value of equity only. So the value of equity equal to the value of the entire company minus the value of debt. So this is the value of equity. And since we have 50 million shares trading in the stock market, when you divide the value of equity by the number of shares, you end up with the value per share. This is what we call it, the real value per share. Again, let me remind you that we reach the real value of stock in order to compare it with the market value of a stock or the market price. If the market price is greater than the real value, so the stock is overvalued, otherwise it is undervalued. In Eurexcel, I'm showing you here screenshots of the steps we have followed, because I have all of the givens here in an Excel sheet, in addition to the equations we need. The first step, as I said, we calculate the equity beta. This is exactly the slope equation. I mean, the sensitivity of the stock return to the index return. You just need to type slope as we did in other exercises. You type equal to slope and open bracket. You highlight the stock return, comma, the index return. This is the equity beta. In order to calculate the asset beta, which we need for the CAPM here, you just need to divide the equity beta by this quantity, and this is what's shown to you here in the toolbar. This is a manual equation. The next step is to calculate the required rate of return using the CAPM. Now it's equal to the risk-free rate of return. I'm showing you the equation in here. So C4 here refers to the risk-free rate of return, is one of the givens, plus the asset beta, which we calculated in here, multiplied by the market risk premium, which is given as well. So we end up with K. In order to calculate the firm value, we apply this model, and again, it's a manual equation. This model is what we have in here, and you have it in your Excel file. I'm providing you the solution. So you end up with the entire value for the firm equal to 3,500 million, 3,500,000,000. And in order to calculate the value of equity, we just exclude the amount of debt. So the equity value equal to the total value for the firm minus the value of debt. This is equal to the equity value. You divide it by the number of stocks outstanding in the market, so you end up with the stock real value. And this is what we did in here. The value of equity equal to the value of the firm minus the value of debt. The firm value is what we calculated using this equation minus the debt, which is given. And then we end up with the real value per share. As I said, we compare it with the market value in order to end up with a decision whether the stock is overvalued or undervalued. Now we'll be moving to the fourth and the last method of common stock valuation.